So today we're just going to be covering the last lecture was about the, of course, the diffusion osmosis and active transport. We also discussed some of the examples of osmosis and active transport. And one example for root hair cells in which both of these processes were working simultaneously. The absorption of water was through osmosis and the absorption of water was absorption of ions was through active transport. Example for diffusion was the alveoli exchange, gas exchange between the capillaries and lungs, alveolar sacs. Other than that, we discussed about active transport in microvilli and gut inside the intestine, how the exchange of substances takes place along against the concentration gradient. Then there were some factors also that affected diffusion. Today we're going to be discussing some of the practicals in order to explain both the processes of diffusion and osmosis. We know diffusion is the net movement of molecules from a region of higher concentration to a region of lower concentration, down the concentration gradient. Down the concentration gradient meaning high to low. And on the other hand, we also know osmosis, which is the net movement of water molecules from a region of higher water potential to lower water potential. Where there's high water molecules, it will move towards the side where there are low number of water molecules. But how are we supposed to prove both the processes, through which experiments? There are two practicals carried out in living things and non-living things, both of them. So let's take a look. So we have, first of all, the practical for diffusion in a non-living system. The non-living system is not humans or plants. We're not discussing the practicals on leaves, on plants, or any living things. Just a basic practical for diffusion on a non-living system. Now for diffusion, we add a crystal of potassium permanganate. Okay, this is a crystal of a substance made from potassium permanganate, KMnO4, twice permanganate, and its color is initially purple, violet, dark purple, and it is added to water. So we have a beaker of water. And we add potassium permanganate inside the beaker. Now the potassium permanganate particles will diffuse with the solvent. Now what's the solvent? The solvent was water. And we have the solute, which is potassium permanganate. You have to remember this if the examiner asks you to define an experiment in which you can prove that diffusion takes place in a non-living system. And how can you prove it in a laboratory? We have this experiment. You take a solvent of water, add potassium permanganate crystals, and then wait. Now the potassium permanganate particles will diffuse with the solvent. Now how will they diffuse with the solvent? If you see, we have a higher concentration of potassium permanganate over here and lower concentration of potassium permanganate inside the water solvent. Now what will happen? The movement will take place like this. And the molecules of potassium permanganate will diffuse. They will spread throughout the solvent. As we know, they move from areas of higher concentration to lower concentration, diffusing throughout the solvent. So after some time, the solvent will look something like this. It would be light in color because it has mixed with the water. As just imagine having a beaker with a transparent liquid such as water and a dark violet. And if you add some impurities or water in it, it will become lighter. Okay, so now a new color would be pinkish or light purple. Why? Because it has now spread over the beaker and diffused with the water solvent. The potassium permanganate particles will be less concentrated in one place in the end, so the color will not be as deep. So the meaning is that, first of all, they were having a darker color. Why? Because they were all, for example, if there were 1,000 particles of potassium permanganate, they were first together in a smaller room together, showing a darker color. But now when they have spread throughout the room, those molecules, those thousand particles are far away from each other, the color will, of course, it will change, it will become lighter and more transparent. So this is one of the practicals. You have to remember how is potassium permanganate used with water to investigate diffusion. We know it moved from the area of higher concentration to lower concentration throughout the solvent. And the color change would be from dark purple on one side, and when after diffusion, it will become pinkish or light purple. For example, this was the water solvent, and we added crystals of potassium permanganate over here. Now, what happened after a period of 15 minutes? This was the color change throughout the liquid. If you see the through diffusion, these particles started to spread gradually throughout the water solvent. And if we plot a graph, concentration against the position. So if you see, highest concentration of potassium permanganate is in the position A, showing the darkest color. Let me change the color. And then we have another lighter concentration at, how do we know it's light concentration? Because the color is also light. We know that there is a very low concentration at point D. Why? Because the color is so light. Got it?
Yes, sir.
So higher concentration will show a darker color because they're all tightly trapped on one place. But after diffusion, it slightly becomes lighter and the deeper color doesn't remain forever. So from the graph, we can see highest concentration at point A, then, and the lowest concentration was at point D. Yes, this one proves the fact. Now, the second investigation, we have diffusion again, but now we are talking about a living system. Now, in a living system, we talk about plants or animals, a practical that can be carried out in plants or animals. So this practical is about the gas exchange that takes place in our lungs. Of course, it would be more thoroughly explained once we covered the chapter of gas exchange, chapter number 12 or 13. But right now, we know that during inhalation, oxygen-rich air enters the alveoli. Whenever we inhale oxygen, fresh air. And fresh air contains rich amounts of oxygen in abundant quantity. Now, there is a higher concentration of oxygen in the alveoli. The inhaled air goes in our lungs, and these lungs contain many alveolar sacs. Now, the absorbed inhaled O2 is in a larger concentration, freshly air inhaled right now, and now it is traveled through the alveoli, and it's stored right now inside the alveoli. So there's a higher concentration of oxygen in the alveoli than in the blood running past the alveoli. So now we have the blood of our body, which has been used up. The oxygenated blood has now turned deoxygenated, and we have many small tiny capillaries running across the alveoli, and they are having a lower concentration of O2. So we can write O2 is in a lower concentration inside the capillaries, which are passing along the alveolar sacs, and we have a higher concentration inside the alveolar sacs. So if we show the oxygenated blood with a red color, we know that higher amounts of oxygen is present inside the alveoli, whereas CO2 inside the deoxygenated blood. So now if I talk about, let's write it down first. So the alveoli contains more O2 and lesser CO2. Whereas the capillaries contain low amounts of O2 but high amounts of CO2. So if I ask you that, in which direction would the diffusion of oxygen take place? Of course, from higher to low. So when we talk about oxygen, oxygen is in higher quantity inside the alveoli than in the capillaries. So of course, the diffusion of oxygen would be in from the alveoli to the capillaries. Now the capillaries are abundant in deoxygenated blood, composing of carbon dioxide in a higher concentration. So the movement of carbon dioxide would be from the capillaries into the alveolar sacs down the concentration gradient. So oxygen will diffuse out of the alveoli down the concentration gradient into blood. At the same time, there is higher concentration of carbon dioxide in the blood from respiration. Our muscle cells carry out respiration. They use oxygen and produce carbon dioxide. Hence, the carbon dioxide produced from respiration is present inside those capillaries. Hence, CO2 is in larger quantity inside the blood. Hence, it will move into the alveoli. The oxygen will move out of the alveoli and the CO2 will move into the alveoli from the blood. So we can write CO2 and we can write O2. So the movement of CO2 would be from blood to alveoli, and the movement of O2 will be from alveoli into the blood. Got it?
Yes, sir.
So carbon dioxide will diffuse out of the blood down the concentration. Of course, when we talk about diffusion, everything is going down the concentration gradient, high to low. Wherever there's a high quantity of carbon dioxide, it will move out. So this is how gas exchange takes place in mammals. The detail will be studied in the upcoming chapters of gas exchange. We breathe in oxygenated blood. We breathe in oxygen. We have oxygenated blood inside alveoli. Higher amount of oxygen in alveoli, lower amount in blood, hence the oxygen will move out of the alveoli into the blood. Same is the case, our body has now produced carbon dioxide. That carbon dioxide will now move into the alveoli for oxygenation or exhalation. For example, we have an alveoli sac over here. This is an alveoli. So you see, deoxygenated blood is always coming inside the alveoli, and oxygenated blood is always diffusing out of the alveoli. This is the capillary. Okay. So we know that oxygen blood comes from the capillary, and when it reaches in this area along the alveoli, okay, this is the point of area. These are the areas where the diffusion will take place. Now what happens is, let me change the pen. So first of all, let's talk about this area, and then we'll discuss about this region. All right, so what happens over here? We have high CO2 inside the capillaries and low amount of CO2 inside the alveoli. Hence the CO2 moves inside. While passing, now we have more oxygenated blood, fresh air containing abundant amount of oxygen now present in large quantities inside the alveoli, and that would be, and we know capillary contain large amounts of carbon dioxide. Hence, down the concentration gradient, either is from blood to alveoli, which is CO2, or if it's alveoli to blood, which is oxygen. Each lung contains 250 million alveoli roundabout, and we know that lungs provide oxygenated blood, and we receive deoxygenated blood from the body, of course, you know, and hence that deoxygenated blood is now traveled through the capillaries along the alveoli for diffusion. Once the diffusion takes place, O2 has entered the capillaries through diffusion, and it is now having deoxygenated blood. So again, let me take that. Okay. The blood from our body containing high amounts of CO2 travels inside the capillaries. It's traveling inside the capillaries. Capillaries pass along the alveoli to release the CO2 and absorb the oxygen. Once they are done with that, the oxygenated blood, fresh oxygenated blood, comes out containing high amount of O2 back to the body. So this is how the diagram explains the whole mechanism. Now this was about diffusion. Now we'll discuss the practicals or the investigation that can be carried out for proving the process of osmosis. We know osmosis is the net movement of water molecules from higher water potential to lower water potential. So in a non-living system, when we don't talk about humans or plants, we have an experiment containing a whisking tube bag. Now, whisking tube is a thin tube, a thin plastic tube in which we can trap air or any type of solution. It has a shape like this, really thin, thinner than polystyrene, and it's a really, really thin, fine line tube, which is partially permeable. Of course, it contains small pores which can allow exchange of substances. You can see these inside the labs. Now we fill a whisking tube bag with sucrose, all right? And the solution is placed into a beaker of water. So what we have done is that we have taken a beaker of water and the whisking tube is dipped inside the water. This is water. And we have it in a higher water potential. Of course, the water is having higher water potential. Now this contains sucrose, which contains low water potential. And we know that osmosis takes place down the concentration gradient, which means high to low. So the movement of this water will be inside the whisking tube. We had a higher water potential outside the whisking tube and a lower water potential inside the whisking tube. So the water moves from the beaker inside the whisking tube. I mean from the solvent inside the whisking tube, because whisking tube was actually having high amounts of sucrose. High amounts of sucrose means lower water, whereas the solvent contained no sucrose, meaning higher water. And inside the whisking tube, we had lower water potential, hence higher water potential to lower water potential. So a capillary tube, a very thin diameter tube, is placed in the bag and the level of liquid in the tube is observed. The concentration of water particles is higher outside. As I said, we have a higher concentration or higher water potential outside in the beaker of water than inside the whisking tube bag. So water molecule will move through the partially permeable membrane of the whisking tubing down the concentration gradient. So what will happen? That we had a higher concentration of water outside, lower inside. The water will move inside through a partially permeable membrane, PPM. Over time, the level of liquid in the capillary tube will rise as more water molecules move into the bag due to osmosis. Now we know the whisking tube or the capillary tube is now gaining water. Of course, when the water is moving inside the whisking tube, it is now not only filled with sucrose, but we have constant water molecules coming inside too. Hence the weight, the mass of the whisking tubing or the diameter of the capillary tube will now increase, of course. So what is happening is that we have this capillary tube. We have water containing higher water potential. And we have the whisking tubing containing lower water potential because we have the sucrose solution inside the tube. The movement of water would be inside. From high to low. And once the water moves inside, the liquid rises inside the capillary tube. Why? Because we have constant water coming inside the whisking tubing. The first effect would be the increase in mass, the increasing weight of the whisking tubing. It will increase in diameter. Same can happen with the capillary tube. The liquid, which was first over here, the level of sucrose solution, it might rise up till here because we have this much water now added inside it through osmosis. Got it? So this is how the whisking tube containing sucrose can prove that how osmosis can take place from a region of higher water potential to a region of lower water potential. You clear? Moving on. Now we have another example of osmosis taking place inside a living system. So we have discussed diffusion in non-living and living. Then we have discussed osmosis in a non-living system too. Now we have the last investigation of osmosis inside a living system. And living system, when we talk about living system, it is either food, plants, humans, or any practical that can involve some living molecules. So the most common osmosis practical involves cutting cylinders of potato and placing them into distilled water. Now, when I say the word distilled water, this means only water molecules. Like we have many kinds of water that contain impurities. They contain ions, magnesium, iron. And when I talk about distilled water is only pure water. It's totally pure water. There are no impurities. It has been distilled. It has been processed with distillation, fraction distillation, completely pure water without any impurities, which means a higher water potential. So the most common osmosis practical involves cutting cylinders of potato. So we have potatoes, and inside a lab, we cut cylinders of potato, like making French fries. The potato cylinders are weighed before placing into the solution. What is the purpose of weighing the potato cylinders? So we can have an accurate experiment. Of course, when we're having equal size potato cylinders, we can have an accurate and a reliable experiment. Otherwise, if they are not equally weighed, if one is big or one is smaller in mass, of course, it will result in the non-reliable results. So they are left in the solution for 20 to 30 minutes. Now, these cylinders are now left. They are now left inside a distilled water solution and then removed and dried to remove excess liquid and remnant. Of course, we know that the distilled water contains higher water potential and there is a lower water potential inside the potato cylinders. So, of course, the movement of water would be from the distilled water inside the beaker into the potato cylinders. So the potato cylinders in the distilled water will have increased its mass the most, as there is a greater concentration gradient in the tube between the distilled water. Higher water concentration, and the potato cells are having a lower water concentration or lower water potential. So again, the distilled water having a higher water potential and the potato cylinder is having a lower water potential. We know osmosis takes place down the concentration gradient from higher water potential to lower water potential. Hence, the water will move from the solvent, which is the distilled water, into the potato cylinders. And of course, that will result the same as it happened with the whisking tubing. When water was more absorbed by the whisking tubing, the mass increased, the weight increased, the size increased. And of course, there would be a size increase and a mass increase inside these potato cylinders. This means more water molecules will move into the potato cells by osmosis, making them turgid. The term turgid we discussed in case of plant cells, when plant cells gain water by osmosis, they become rigid, they become hard, and they maintain their shape. Of course, the shape of the potato cylinders don't change. The only difference is that they increase in diameter or they increase in mass. Otherwise, they maintain their cylindrical shape, making them turgid and increasing the mass of the cylinders. Got it?
Yes, sir.
So the potato cylinder in the strongest sucrose concentration. Now we have placed the potato cylinders inside the strongest sucrose concentration, which means that the solvent is having high amount of sucrose, meaning low amount of water. As we know, the potato cylinder in the strongest sucrose core will have decreased its mass the most, as there is a greater concentration gradient in the tube. How? Because we know now, at first they were placed in distilled water. Now, distilled water had a higher water potential. But now when we're talking about a strong sucrose concentration, imagine a glass of water with 4 spoons of sugar. Now there is so much sugar that the concentration of water molecules have decreased and the solute has increased. Same is the case over here. We have a higher amount of sucrose inside the solvent and a lower water potential inside the, of course, when we talk about higher solute, meaning lower water, which means that the potato cylinders have higher water potential. Hence, the potato cells having higher water concentration or potential and the sucrose solution having lower water concentration. What will happen? There would be have a decrease in mass of the potato cylinders. If we have a size of potato cylinder of around 4 centimeter, they might have reduced diameter, they might have increased in mass. Of course, the size, the diameter, the mass, the weight of the potato cylinders will now decrease. Why? Because they will lose water. The water will move outside the potato cylinders into the sucrose solution. This means more water molecule will move out of the potato cells by osmosis, making them flaccid. Now the term flaccid, we discussed in case of animal cells. When animal cells lose water, they become flaccid. Now flaccid is a loose term meaning irregular shape. So the fries, the potato cylinders, or if you imagine a French fry being shrinked, losing its cylindrical or rectangular shape, becoming flaccid. Flaccid is a term, is completely opposite for turgid. Turgid was hard, flaccid is soft. Turgid was upright, flaccid is an irregular shape, while as whereas turgidity was maintaining the shape, having a regular shape. Flaccid meaning losing the shape, becoming irregular, becoming flaky, and hence decreasing in the mass of the potato cylinders. If there is a potato cylinder that has not increased or decreased in mass, it means there was no overall movement of water into or out of the potato cells. For example, if the student gets the same result initially and after. For example, initially, if the potato cylinder had a mass of, let's say, 0.5 grams or 5 grams, and at the end of the experiment, it had the same mass, the conclusion would be that there was no net movement of water molecules into or out of the potato cylindrical cells. Or you can say there was no osmosis which took place. This is because the solution that cylinder was, it was the same concentration as the solution found in the cytoplasm of the potato cells. So there was no concentration gradient. So we have total of 3 cases, okay? The first case was when the potato cylinders were placed inside the distilled water. Let me tell you. Okay. We had the first case, and we have second case, and then we have the third case. The first case was the distilled water. The second case included the solvent of sucrose. And a third one we'll discuss after these two. Now, distilled water, we know, contains high water potential. Sucrose contains low water potential. Hence, the result for both of these experiments was, in case of distilled water, the water moved from the solvent into the potato cylinders. In case of sucrose, the water moved from the potato cylinders into the solvent. Okay, then the student says, what if the mass of the potato cylinders remains same? This would mean that the concentration of water inside and outside was the same. They both had equal concentrations inside and outside, which means that no osmosis took place. For example, we have these potato cubes placed in pure water. Also, you can say distilled water. The pure water is also known as distilled water. We have the potato splinters in pure water or the distilled water. The potato tubes swell because the water enters their cell by osmosis. Same is the case, a rich sugar solution or sucrose solution. The potato tube shrink or become flaccid. Now the term here for pure water can be distilled water. The term used for swell can be turgid. Here the rich sugar solution can indicate the sucrose solution and the potato tube shrink, or you can say become flaccid because the water leaves their cells due to osmosis. Then the same case was with the whisking tubing containing the sugar solution, meaning lower water potential, pure water having a higher water potential. The movement was inside. The water rises up the tube because water enters through the whisking tube by osmosis. The glucose molecules are too big to diffuse into the water. And so that was it for today, and it marks the end of the chapter. So in whole chapter, we have covered diffusion, osmosis, active transport, their examples in gas exchange, digestion, villi, absorption of water inside root hair cells by plants, humans, both examples. And then we have also covered the different factors that affect the rate of diffusion. And moreover, we have covered investigations, two for diffusion, non-living and living, and same for osmosis, living and non-living. The common experiment that can be asked in your paper is of the potato cylinders experiment, and the other one is whisking tubing. Diffusion is quite rare, but the four investigations has to be thoroughly revised by you in order to understand the chapter.